Jon Schnepp here. You're watching Heroes, episode 24, and we are ready to bring you the cinematic and televised world of superheroes and supervillains. With me, as always, is John Campea. What's up, John?
It's a hot day in Burbank. Oh. We just walked to lunch and back, and we're all like, oh.
Yeah, it's 101, oh. Right?
So yeah, right now it is. Unbelievable. Woo.
And here we are, getting ready to be turned into lobsters because we turned the AC off. We got Robert Meyer Burnett joining us once again.
Hey. How you doing, John? John, I want to thank you for having me here today. It's kind of a special day for me.
Why is that?
Star Trek's 49th birthday. Whoa. Today.
Wow.
It's 49th birthday today. 1966, The Man Trap aired on September 8th. It was written by George Clayton Johnson, who co-wrote the novel Logan's Run.
Nice. Very and also, cool. That episode has a very special meaning to me, because I used to terrorize my sister, Deb. When I was a little kid, I had this book, the very first Star Trek. It was like the making of Star Trek. And in the middle of it, it had like eight color pages. And one of them was the salt sucker creature with the, ooh. So I would go, hey, Deb. And she'd turn her head and I'd be like, salt sucker. Give her nightmares. I was that little brother who would like terrorize the sister with horrible images of mummies and stuff like that.
That's the job of a little brother.
I very much think so. And she was my protector, you know. So thank you, Deb, for being awesome.
You know, Trek does have a very rich comic history. It was Gold Key, then it was Marvel, then it was DC, then it was Marvel again, then it was Wildstorm and IDW. There's almost 50 years of Star Trek comics.
Totally. So. Yeah, there's a ton of them that are a lot of fun. I personally love the more recent John Byrne comics that IDW published. If you could check them out, there's a hardcover of everything he did. It was like, he did like a 5-episode McCoy, and it's all old Star Trek. It's like the first 3 seasons Star Trek with the Romulans and the Klingons. And if you know who I'm talking about, John Byrne's a really great writer, artist who, you know, got famous doing the X-Men and Fantastic Four, a great run in the 80s. And he's moved on to a lot of other creator-owned stuff. But he went back to do Star Trek, and for some reason, that Star Trek run just hit it for me. I don't know if you
Oh, it's great. I loved it. He also did a Gary 7
totally,
run. You
totally.
Know, he did Gary 7 from Assignment Earth, which was the second season. It was a backdoor pilot for a show that never
deep
happened.
Deep sweat, ladies and gentlemen. deep sweat.
And also, you know what he's doing now? Byrne is doing photo novels.
I don't
IBM.
Like him. I don't. Reason really? I don't like him is because he's mixing and matching. Like every third panel, it's Spock from like the pilot. I'm like, yo, dude, keep the shirts at least the same color, son. This isn't a Rob Liefeld comic. It's like a lot Rob Liefeld comic, but done with photos. Like every third panel, I'm wearing a different outfit. Or like I magically have a belt buckle on my shoulder for no reason.
The stories are pretty cool, though.
Hey, look, I can't even, I'm visual. I can't get past that like flip-flopping. It's old Spock, new Spock, weird, like plush, like a pleated outfit, cheap looking, and then all of a sudden he's fitted. I just can't get over it. So, all right, guys, we're going to rock on into the very first story, and it's a big story. It's Civil War in the Marvel offices. So this past week, Kevin Feige is now going to report to Alan Horn, circumventing Ike Perlmutter, as well as the Marvel Creative Committee has been completely disbanded, no longer giving notes to the film division. So we still have Jeph Loeb in charge of television reporting to Ike Perlmutter. But what does this mean for Phase 4 and the future? While we're at it, Disney, this was also released, Disney's calling Age of Ultron a financial failure after making $1.4 billion at the box office. How will these new moves clear the upcoming slate for bigger bucks? John, what do you think? Let's talk first of all about the circumventing of Ike Perlmutter. What's all that? And then disbanding the actual Marvel movie committee. What's going
on? I want to know what moron at Disney is calling a $1.4 billion film financial failure. You're an idiot. Just shut up. Okay, so that being said, there's a couple of interesting ways, and we talked a little bit about it on Movie Talk, but there's a few interesting keys here to take a look at. Number one is the part that makes me a little bit nervous. When filmmakers get too much power, bad things have happened. I mean, we saw what happened once George Lucas entered an era of his life and his career that he didn't have to answer to anybody. We got the prequels.
I think it wasn't that the King George era, I think it was called. Because everyone surrounding him was, yes, George. Yes, George.
Everything. George was completely surrounded by yes men. Nobody had the power to say no to him, blah, blah, blah. I mean, we look what happened with M. Night Shyamhammer. Like, he was an aspiring filmmaker, like, looked like a great start to his career and stuff like that. But the more power he got, and then the infamous story about Lady in the Water, when Disney tried to bring him some notes, say, look, we have some concerns. And he was like, basically, double efforts to Disney. Screw you. No one's ever going to tell me how to do my films. And we ended up getting one of the worst pieces of garbage in the history of cinema with Lady in the Water. And we saw everything else he did after that.
Right.
Once filmmakers get too much power, they don't have those checks and balances to people keep them in line, Things can go bad. Now, I'm not saying that's what's going to happen with Kevin Feige. Kevin Feige is a hero of mine. He's great. But the one thing has been the relationship between Perlmutter and Feige, while maybe a little bit contentious, and Perlmutter is, as the CEO of Marvel Entertainment, he is very financially tight. He's cheap. He's very cheap. But the formula, however contentious, has clearly worked. It's worked to the tune of a company calling a $1.4 billion movie their failure. That's how good this formula has worked. Now, so taking Kevin Feige out from under Perlmutter, no longer having that check and balance, he's going under a guy like Disney chairman Alan Horn. Well, be careful what you wish for. Now, Alan Horn is a beloved figure at Disney, actually. I was actually in the room with Robert Downey Jr. when Alan Horn just kind of decided to come in because he was in the building and wanted to say hi to Robert Downey Jr. Robert loves, you know, Horn. He has a great relationship with a lot of the talent at Disney and stuff like that, so that can be good, too. So maybe we get to see Kevin Feige have a little bit more creative reign, but don't just automatically think that's a good thing because creative people without checks and balances to report to can turn bad real fast. The other thing that we talked about that was a big deal, though, is that while Kevin Feige has been able to move the film division out from under Perlmutter and under Horn directly, the television division is still directly under Perlmutter, which just kind of suggests, I'm not saying this is definite, it just suggests it to me, that this separation between the film world and the television world is just going to continue to increase. They're still going to say they're in the same cinematic universe. I think you're still going to see the TV shows try to mimic and reflect what's going on in the movie universe, but I also think the trend that the movie universe is never going to reference the TV shows, I think that's going to continue, maybe even get a little bit wider. So there's a lot of interesting political dynamics. This is a great Hollywood story in the making. I see them making a movie about this at some point in the future. Lots of cool things that could be going on here.
What do you think, Robert?
Well, I think, look, talent relationships are the most important thing in Hollywood. I think that you've got Kevin Feige, who's also one of my heroes. He's trying to build a franchise that requires his talent to be the same from movie to movie to movie. Robert Downey Jr. was not originally going to be in Civil War. I think they wrote him into Civil War. And obviously his time at Marvel was running out. He was not contracted to do Civil War, but they came up with such a good idea. They went to him, and of course, it was going to be expensive. It was going to cost an arm and a leg. And I'm sure Perlmutter said, we're not paying Robert Downey Jr. I'm sure this is where the rift... Look, I have no inside knowledge of this, but I would assume that when Perlmutter said, no, we're not paying Robert Downey Jr. this money, I bet that's where the bone of contention began. And I'm sure Feige went to Alan Horn and said, why can't we do this? And Alan Horn's like, of course, we should do this. And that's probably where the split came. And now you've got, we'll talk about Chris Evans wanting to be Captain America forever. You've got to pay these people because they're bringing in hundreds of millions, if not billions of dollars to this studio over the course of how much are these movies worth? How much do they keep? They're evergreen titles. They're never going to go out of style. And you cannot, you start getting bean counters getting in the way of making these movies, it's never going to work. Now, I agree with you that I think someone like Alan Horn is a strong enough studio exec. He came over from Warner Brothers. He knows what's going on. He's not going to let profligate spending happen. These films, for as expensive as the Avengers get, the other movies, like Ant-Man, they're making these movies for price. Mm-hmm. They're not allowing these movies to go wildly out of control, like, say, Spectre, that costs $300 million to make. They're still keeping them reasonably inexpensive. I mean, the Avengers movies are a special case. But I'm hoping that the film division will have more freedom and Feige won't have to deal with Perlmutter getting in the way if they want to bring back another character from a different franchise, if they want to extend Sam Jackson's contract, for instance.
Yeah, I think
he can do that.
I think all of these points you guys brought up are very strong. We mentioned earlier that Perlmutter is also, he answers to the shareholders of Marvel. So some of the moves that he's done don't jibe with like comic book fans. Like he canceled the Fantastic Four. He tried to cancel Deadpool mainly because Fox owns them. So he was like, look, you can't ever have action figures of the Fantastic Four. You'll never have action figures of the X-Men again. They did like for the very first movie, there was a limited amount of action figures. Then they like froze that off. So, and you'll see all of the Marvel comic books now are kind of promoting all the other characters except for the X-Men and the Fantastic Four.
I mean, I think that's horrible in the sense that, you know, they might have made a deal for the X-Men 17 years ago, right. but they still made that deal.
Yeah.
And what they're not doing is they're still Marvel characters. Those toys are still going to be made by Marvel. Yeah. And the profits are going to be... I'll tell you something. Let me talk about Hot Toys figures. I don't think I haven't talked about Hot Toys figures.
Bring those Hot Toys
you
back
cannot,
into it.
The only Hot Toys X-Men they make is Wolverine. I have 4 Wolverine Hot Toys figures. I do not have any other Hot Toys figures. They made Days of Future Past Wolverine. I wanted all of the Days of Future Past. Did you see they announced Hot Toys Force Awakens figures this
yes.
week?
Yeah.
3 different Stormtroopers, 3 different First Order Stormtroopers, and Kylo Ren. I about soiled myself. But I can't get X-Men figures. Come
Is there going to be a Captain Phasma that's all silvery?
I am so excited for a Hot Toys Captain Phasma. I can't yeah. even begin to tell you.
Let's detract a little.
But,
let's go
but
away
back
from
to Perlmutter.
Yeah, let's get
you know,
back to Perlmutter.
I'm just saying that why can't... The fact that they're getting rid of... Now it's the uncanny Avengers. It's not like it's right. not the uncanny X-Men anymore. I mean, why would Perlmutter cancel... The Fantastic Four, simply because, oh, they're owned by a rival studio, but Marvel can still publish those characters. Those are cornerstone characters.
I think, yeah, but let's keep this in mind, too. Let's keep this in mind, too. Like, we all like to talk about how, you know, Marvel canceled Fantastic Four because they don't like Fox. Bull. They canceled Fantastic Four because, newsflash, nobody on the frickin' planet read Fantastic Four. Literally, 4 times the amount of people who read Fantastic Four are going to watch this episode of Heroes. It was down to about just north of 20,000 issues were right. sold a month. Nobody read the damn thing.
But here's
that's why it got canceled.
Here's the unfortunate additional news flash. Nobody reads comics, period.
Mm.
So, granted, Fantastic
Four... We don't like to talk about that, though.
No, but I'm just saying, Fantastic Four, sure, 20,000... People were buying that, but what's the top-selling comic right now? 65,000. That's the honest truth. Comics don't move like they did, especially like in their prime, well, like the late 80s, 1 million copies of X-Men. That's not happening
now.
What
about digital downloads? Are you talking
less,
issues sold or
less,
digital downloads?
Less. I'm talking about issues sold.
Total.
There's less digital yeah. downloads. Let's not even joke about that. That's in its infancy. Like people are still buying digital downloads, but it's not the same amount of people who are buying actual comic books, and that's hardly anybody. So let's just put it into perspective, you know, and you guys who are all Heroes fans and people who love superhero movies, you got to do all of the people who are the writers and the artists of these comic books a little bit of gratitude and go to your local comic book store before it closes, because they're all closing because no one's buying comic books. But comic books have now become a giant commercial for whatever the next movie is going to be.
It's
and
true.
The only reason
or
that
an
is...
Or an audition to become a movie.
Or an audition yeah. to become a movie. And the only reason that is happening is because you guys are not buying comics. I'm not blaming you, but I'm saying all you people who are brand new fans and say you love superhero movies, you got to start to... And look, there's people like all of us who've read a ton of comics. Listen to the comics that we suggest for you to buy. We won't steer you wrong. We'll make a special by the end of this year of like, here's the top 50 comics that you should have in your collection. We'll do that for you guys so that you can feel good about like, hey, I spent, you know, $500, but I just learned so much. Or let's even say $100, maybe $100 on Amazon. But we'll make sure that happens. But whatever happens with Ike Perlmutter and Kevin Feige, I personally think it's actually a good thing that they separated. If they were starting to have real big beefs, if it was over Tony Stark being in Civil War, if it was just became a contentious relationship, yeah, the first phase one and even phase two of Marvel worked, but who was the actual guy who made these phases happen? Yes, Kevin Feige came in after Iron Man and Hulk were already in the get-go, but he's the guy who solidified everything. He's the guy who created this entire phaseology, if you want to speak about it. He's kind of the linchpin of what is the cinematic universe. And it's better that he's, you know, he's let free to do phase 4, phase 5, or whatever it's going to be. And maybe Ike Perlmutter will actually shine just being in charge of the television series.
Oh, this could be a best of both. This could be a win-win-win. As long as Alan Horn, and he's not known to do this, so I think we're pretty safe. As long as Alan Horn doesn't just say, hey, Kevin, tell you what, look, just your mother's away. Do whatever you want. That's just fine. As long as Horn can act as that check and balance, this could be a very positive thing for everybody involved.
Yeah, definitely. We all want that to happen. Speaking of positivity, Captain America Forever, what's up? Chris Evans just recently said the words that we always wanted to hear him say. He stated that even though his contract's up after the next Avengers double feature, he'd be willing to play Captain America Forever. He basically said, look, this is the most fun I've ever had working on any set of movies. Every Marvel movie that comes out is great. They make sure that it's a fun thing. He's been in a bunch of movies where he's like, is this movie going to be good? He never has to worry about that when he steps into the role of Steve Rogers as Captain America. And come on, man, this is like a dream come true for any actor or actress. If you're set up in a movie franchise like this, every couple of years, he's directing his own feature films. He's doing some lower budget independent stuff. It's just good for cinema as a whole when you have blockbuster films and you let actors and actresses and even directors and writers from those big movies play and make independent films and then go back and play and make the big films. What do you guys think? What do you think, John?
I think this is fantastic. Captain America has turned into my favorite character in the Marvel Cinematic Universe. And in part because of Chris Evans. I mean, brilliant writing of the character, the way they've handled him. They've also been addressing the character as we've been going along. My one concern a little bit about, you know, the first Avengers one was Steve Rogers was clearly the leader of the team, and yet they weren't really promoting him such. Once you get into Age of Ultron, he's the leader of the team. He's becoming, I mean, I know this, people will hate that I use this analogy, but he's becoming the Batman of this universe. Right. He really is. And the other cast members love Chris Evans. I remember we were talking to the guys playing, why am I forgetting the actor's name now?
Playing who?
Who plays Falcon.
Anthony Mackie.
Talking to Anthony Mackie, and he was talking about how everybody loves him. Like, you gotta understand, everybody loves Chris. He goes, when Chris shows up, the set lights up. Everybody loves working with Chris. And then I remember this one time at a press conference. This is back when that Batman vs. Superman and Captain America Civil War were supposed to open on the same day still. It was supposed to open the same weekend. And they were at a press conference for Captain America, the Winter Soldier, somewhere in Europe. And somebody asked the question about, you know, is one of you guys going to move? And Anthony Mackie goes, hey, look, because the question, the person asked the question is, you know, they got Batman, they got Superman, whatever. And Anthony Mackie just grabs the mic at the table and goes, we got Chris Evans. And that's kind of how Chris is thought of amongst his crew. This is also a great move for Chris. Chris will never have a bigger role in his life or have bigger hits in his life than these Marvel Cinematic Universe films. For him to come back, commit to it, and say, look, I will come back as long as they want me coming back, that is great news. It also reassures me that Captain America, Steve Rogers, is not dying at the end of Captain America Civil War in this, since he's already shooting, you know, Avengers Infinity Part 1 and Part 2, and he's saying, and I'm going to come back for as long as they want me. This is good for everybody. There's no downside to this.
Well, I mean, how many actors, if you think about franchise movies, Indiana Jones, there's been four. How good are they? Now you've got Chris Evans is now going to be in his fifth. Civil War is going to be his fifth time at bat as Captain America. I loved Avengers Age of Ultron. I think everything he's been in has been great in terms of playing Captain America. How many actors get James Bond films? Never that. Star Trek movies, Star Wars movies. In terms of franchise success and franchise quality, I don't think an actor could ask for Kevin Feige's custodianship of the entire Marvel Universe to be better. I think any actor who gets to play one of these iconic roles knows that there's no place they would be in better hands. I mean, DC, how many Batmans have we seen now?
Right.
I mean, wouldn't it have been nice to see, say, whether it was Michael Keaton getting four Batman movies? We did get to see Christian Bale do three, but to have the kind of quality, I mean, every actor, all they want to do is be in good movies.
Right.
And play a character that's memorable, that everyone loves. He's loved by four generations of people as Captain America, and he's great. And they make great Hot Toys Captain America figures.
Someone has an obsession. Let's talk about another person who's obsessed, Tommy Wiseau. He recently in an article, he was being interviewed in a magazine. He said he wants to direct the Fantastic Four. After the critical and box office failure of Fox's Fantastic Four, many wonder who they might pick to direct the sequel. Well, fear not, cinema fans. The Room's very own Tommy Wiseau has spoken out in an interview declaring that he wouldn't mind directing the sequel and wondered aloud why it's too bad they didn't call me. He's open and ready to talk commission fees, Fox. So get on it. I think maybe a Uwe Boll or perhaps Alan Smithy could do the third and the fourth one. Let's talk about this. And what does this really mean? When people are talking about, like, in the news, they're kind of making jokes about Tommy Wiseau as an aside, like, hey, it's too bad they didn't call me. You know, I would have thought about it. What do you think that really means, Robert?
Well, I think, look, he needs a job. You know, and no one's going to hire him to do the Fantastic Four. I mean, let's face it, The Room is no work of cinematic genius on any level. I mean, it's renowned as being one of the worst movies ever made. It's the new Rocky Horror. Right. Well, maybe not quite Rocky Horror, right, because it doesn't have audience participation. It doesn't have 40 years of fans behind it.
You throw spoons. That's about
it's
it.
Just not. But I think it was a funny thing for him to say. And I think if somebody wants to become relevant in the press in Hollywood for another week, they can say something like that. We're talking about him. So obviously it worked.
Right.
So good for him. But you know what? There is part of me that wouldn't mind seeing what would happen if he did direct the new Fantastic
Four. It's like not being able to look away from a train wreck. I mean,
truly, truly.
The funny thing is that obviously Tommy Wiseau would love to direct Fantastic Four. Obviously, would 1,000 other directors in this town love to direct Fantastic Four? Of course, but we would not be having this conversation about Tommy Wiseau saying that he wants to direct it had Fantastic Four been a success, had it been a good film. But because it was a failure of a film, we will talk about, hey guys, Tommy Wiseau wants to direct it. How about that, huh? And really, this story is not about Tommy, really. It's not about him. Of course he wants to direct it. I want to direct it. Everybody at this table would love to direct Fantastic Four. That's not the issue. The issue is that we are now equating the property of Fantastic Four with the likes of Tommy Wiseau. Now, if you really want to know what happened with Fantastic Four, watch Dennis Zenn's short parody on what happened between Josh Trank and the executives at Fox. It's online now, right, Dennis?
Yeah,
and
it's Think Hero Pro. You can check it out.
Watch it. It is hilarious. It really is. And it's probably the most accurate depiction of what actually went down than we will ever see, I think. Yeah. So make sure you find that. Yeah. But yeah, it's kind of a
You guys can stop tweeting me about making the death of Fantastic Four what happened.
And
all
just
you have
watch
to do
Dennis
is watch
short.
Dennis's thing. And that's kind of it in a nutshell. But why I brought this up is actually something to talk about. It's true. It has nothing to do with Tommy Wiseau. It has everything to do with like a property being lowered in the minds of people who like probably never read a Fantastic Four comic in their life. And that's one of the reasons I wanted to bring it up. It's like, I would hate to see Tommy Wiseau direct the Fantastic Four. That would be a nightmare come true. It'd be like, if I woke up tomorrow, I was like, that article is actually real. I'd be like, who do I have to kill to make this not happen?
If they ever announced that, today, two announcers for Fox. Fox announced that, number one, Tommy Wiseau has been hired to direct Fantastic Four 2. Also, and prepare your swear beepers for folks. Also, Fox also announced they've changed the name of their company to Fox We Don't Give a Fuck.
That's
right. The new name of the company. Those two announcements would come side by side.
It would be Fox You. It's brand new. It's a brand new corporation, News Corp. Fox You. I would not be able to even handle that. But when I read that, it made me realize, like, wow, this property in other people's minds, it's now kind of a joke.
Yeah.
And now people are openly like, hey, what about this idiot? Would he look, Tommy Wiseau, I'm sorry, I'm not trying to call you an idiot. The Room is its own classic and its own, you know, set of parameters of film fun fandom. But what I'm trying to say is, what will it take to make Fantastic Four 2, or if they reboot it completely, what will it take to make that property fresh and exciting to an audience again now that these multiple different films have come out and not hit it?
Well, you know, I think, look, I talked about before the Alex Garland, Danny Boyle team that could come in. I think if you get an exciting, people will go see any movie if they can tell it's going to be good.
Yep.
And I think from the very beginning, there was something about the drabness of those Fantastic Four trailers. There was nothing that excited you. In the world that we live in today, when you have Guardians of the Galaxy, you've got these brightly, you've got Jurassic World. Look at this summer. We had Avengers Age of Ultron, Fast or Furious 7, and Jurassic World that have become in the top 10 all-time grossing movies. And when you went to the theater and you saw those trailers, you knew they were going to be, look, Jurassic World might just be a remake of Jurassic Park, but at least it was entertaining. You came out of there and felt, okay, kids loved it. I sat in a theater full of people that loved it. Furious 7 was not my favorite film of the franchise, even though I love that franchise. I just love that it's going to keep going. Now, the Fantastic Four, if you get a filmmaker that delivers, any movie can be brought back from the brink of disaster. Anyone. As long as you have the right creative team that's working not at odds with the studio. And that's what they've proven with Disney and Marvel, whether it's Ike Perlmutter and Kevin Feige working together or apart, they know what they're doing. And they might rule with an iron fist, but they're bringing in really interesting directors. They're making crazy choices. And I don't think that Fox has that kind of relationship with their filmmakers.
Right.
And if you brought a fantastic filmmaker in to work on Fantastic Four and works with the studio to create something great, it could be brought back from the brink.
It's too late. It's too late. Three strikes and you are out. Like, I would agree with you, and there's a part of me that does agree with you, except for the fact that this is now in a very short window of time. Right. Three Fantastic Four movies that are failures. And I think at this point, to just bring in the great tandem you were suggesting, it would not be enough to change the public perception of this franchise at this point. I think there's only one way to save this thing now. Number one, everybody knows I am not for properties going back to Marvel. I'm not for it. But I am willing to make an exception for Fantastic Four now. Fox has taken three big swings of the bat at it, and they've whiffed every single time. But the one way I think Fox can redeem this, we talked about on a previous episode, his name is Bryan Singer. You let them take whatever the next installment of the X-Men franchise is going to be, you let him shepherd your comic book universe at this point on. You have him, on a small role, introduce a Reed Richards character in an X-Men film, because everybody loves the X-Men at this point. Nobody's hating on X-Men like they are about Fantastic Four. And then you spin that off into its own Fantastic Four film. I think then it has a shot. Maybe then you bring in Boyle and whatever. But it has to start with giving somebody, appointing your own Kevin Feige. And I think at Fox, it's got to be Bryan Singer.
You know what? We talked about that, and I agreed with you before seeing the film. But now that I've seen Fantastic Four, I don't think they could merge those worlds.
You have to reboot it.
Yeah, it would have to be rebooted. Yeah. But I just don't see them. If the Fantastic Four film was a little bit more of a success, where they could still maintain keeping the younger actors, because I think the whole idea was like what they were growing the Fantastic Four to be was a merger with the X-Men.
I agree.
They were going to make a shared unit.
There is an X-Men versus Fantastic Four script.
There's a script that was already it's already done. They were like, look, we'll do that. We'll do Fantastic Four, then we'll have Fantastic Four versus the X-Men or meet the X-Men, then we'll have Fantastic Four 2. That didn't pan out, and it's not going to pan out. I don't think these actors who are in this Fantastic Four movie are going to be in the next Fantastic Four, whatever it's going to be. I don't think they're going to have a sequel in 2 years. It'd be stupid. Have to let the dust settle and then do a brand new reboot with a completely different cast, a totally different idea. And unfortunately, I think, fortunately, the X-Men universe that Brian has been shepherding, it's going in its own path. And it's like definitely whatever the apocalypse is going to be, whatever after the apocalypse is going to be, maybe we're going to have a brand new team of X-Men, whether it's going to be set in the 80s or 90s, I don't know, but I'm excited about it. I don't want it to be teamed up or, you know, transmutated with the Fantastic Four. It's working on its own as an X-Men universe.
I think, look, if they can bring Batman back from after Batman and Robin, after Mr. Freeze and mm-hmm. after all of that, I had no faith in a new Batman franchise when Christopher Nolan took over. I mean, he'd done what? Insomnia?
Right.
He did Memento. Those are cool. And then he did Insomnia. I'm like, that's a really interesting filmmaker, but they gave him Batman Begins? And then once you see Batman Begins, 10 minutes into that movie, you're like, oh.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and it's a totally different approach. I think if you did that, if you had somebody like Christopher Nolan come in of that ilk, they could make Fantastic Four work. But then again, they're going to be fighting an uphill battle because the press is going to be gunning for them. We're going to be gunning for them. Everyone's going to
have faith.
They know. But if you made it cool, if it came out and you showed somebody something, if you can always get an audience back if you do something cool. You can always bring them back.
No, I agree. I think
you can bring them back to anything.
I think what fans have not seen yet is the Stan Lee Jack Kirby Fantastic Four.
That's
exactly what I would want to see. I want to push for that.
Or the John Byrne.
Well, John Byrne is basically the amalgam of Stan Lee and Jack Kirby, just updating everything that those guys came up with and created and just spinning new stories out of that. But what I'm saying is, like, that is what was fantastic to me. I mean, they tried to do that in this new Fantastic Four by going horror sci-fi, but I think now seeing what, you know, especially the way the studio meddled with it, I don't know if I would even trust anybody who's in charge of Fox, the Fantastic Four people who are in charge now, to trust them to be able to make another Fantastic Four. You'd have to fire all those idiots and make sure their other Fox people look, get other producers to be in charge of the Fantastic Four.
Like Kevin Feige?
Well, look, I'm saying if Fox is going to hold on to it, they have to get rid of the morons who ruined this $120 million Fantastic Four by toying with it and taking away scenes for, you know, oh, we don't have the budget for this action film or do this and that. It's just like when you read about all the stupidity involved in the making of this Fantastic Four movie, you can only point to the idiot executives. So literally, I mean, you know, there's fault to share with everybody, I'm sure, but there's giant missteps done on the creative side of the producers. So those people all have to have that wrested away from them and given to other people who actually know what they're doing, especially with Fantastic Four, the property and superhero films and action films in general. You don't cut action films from superhero movies. You just
action scenes. Yeah.
Action sequences. Yeah. Yeah, it's just the dumbest thing you possibly do. All right, let's move on to something I'm calling Waterman Rising. Jason Momoa thinks the Aquaman jokes will stop after we see Batman vs. Superman come out. Obviously, he knows something that we don't. Remember, Spicy Larry controls 75% of all marine life with just his thoughts. He can summon 500 hammerhead sharks and 30 sperm whales to womp on your ass. I demand to see him riding a swordfish in this film, or at least in James Wan's Aquaman. Because when you see this picture of Jason Momoa as the king of Atlantis,
yeah,
you are in awe. You are like, I will see this movie. This is like a superhero movie on 300 drugs. It's just like, I want to see this movie. I want to see this character. It's really fascinating and exciting. When I first heard Jason Momoa was got the role of Aquaman, I was like, that's cool. I know they're going with the dark tone. Then I saw that. I was like, I'm sold. Whatever they're going to do with the Atlanteans and however they're going to, you know, whatever they're going to do, I can't wait. What do you think, John?
Well, I mean, I remember, first of all, I have to call myself out. I was talking to a bunch of friends of mine, and I, for whatever reason, there's a stretch of about 2 weeks where I kept referring to Aquaman as the King of Atlanta. And I kept saying King, and then finally I had a friend point out, why do you keep saying Atlanta? I'm like, am I saying Atlanta? Yeah, okay, he's the King of Atlantis. I remember way back in the day when, in the comic books, they put Aquaman through his, at the time, the biggest transformation he'd ever gone through. They had that one storyline where he lost his hand,
right,
and he took on an entirely F you everybody attitude.
Got the beard, got long the beard, hair.
And I remember that was the start of some people going, wait a minute, Aquaman can be actually kind of cool.
Yep.
And then I still remember when we all first saw this picture. Obviously, that's the Aquaman they're going for. They showed this picture, and we were all like, sign us up. And you know, I was one of those guys making the Aquaman jokes, you know.
Sure.
I was going along with those little dibs they did on Fantastic, or not on Fantastic, on Family Guy, about how useless Aquaman is and stuff like that, right? Where like the girl was getting attacked by a rapist on the beach, Aquaman help me, and Aquaman's just standing in the beach in the water going, hey, you better stop that, you better not come in the water, you know, right, joking around. And then I had a bunch of our fans say, John, read the Aquaman New 52. And so I started reading Aquaman New 52, and I was like, yeah, I'm on board. I'm totally on board. I cannot wait to see what Momoa's. That image, though, is still just striking. Absolutely striking, and I cannot wait to see what they're going to do with him.
Well, see, what I dig about Aquaman is I've always felt that Aquaman is an alien. Mm. He inhabits an alien world that just happens to be on our own.
Right.
You know, the undersea kingdom.
Great analogy.
We don't know what's underneath the water. We have explored so little. You know, until James Cameron discovers the Atlanteans, wouldn't that be cool if that's how he discovered right, in the movie? You know, he goes down to the bottom of the Mariana Trench and, wow, there's people down here.
Right.
But, if you treat him that way, the same way that, in a way, Diana Prince is from Paradise Island, which is another alien environment on
right,
Earth,
right,
and the conflict that the surface dwellers we have with the Atlanteans, I always thought was really interesting. And they could do a lot of really cool stuff with that.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that, the undersea realm, the same way they portrayed Krypton in Man of Steel, if we get that portrayal or something of that ilk in Zack Snyder's Batman versus Superman, it could be really neat. And look at that. Who doesn't like that?
Yeah,
I mean, that's kind of like what John Carter of Mars should have looked like.
Yeah,
and,
for real.
You know, it has that badass, like you said, a 300 vibe to it. I mean, I want a Hot Toys figure of that Aquaman.
You'll be getting one. You know, it's funny you bring that up because a couple weeks ago, one of the costume designers had mentioned, like, you know, you could see some Kryptonian elements in Wonder Woman. And then it's like, you know, in the Superman and Man of Steel, they had that little comic where Kara, Superman's
cousin. The
pre-film
cousin, comic book.
Yeah, it had, you know, but it's canon. So it's like his cousin, Supergirl, in the movie version, got to Earth 20,000 years before he did and wandered off.
Now, that's the ship that Kal-El finds in Man of Steel. And if you remember, As he's walking through the ship, he finds a life pod in there, right. And it's opened and empty. One is open and has a skeleton in it. One is open and empty. And in that prequel comic, we saw that after she crashes, Kara gets out and walks away, and that's the last of you that you see of her.
Yes. So, in theory, she could have not only seeded Wonder Woman's secret island of Amazons, but she could also be in some way responsible for Atlantis. Like the people, some of them drifted off and had superpowers and started, you know, being able to go underwater. We don't really know, but I think that could be, you know, a pretty acceptable way of describing these things.
People talked about that. I remember when that theory first sort of dropped, and there was a lot of fans that were like up in arms about this. But in the universe, that's an interesting, even scientific way of explaining, like, the gods of Olympus, right. for instance. Right. You know, yeah. We're Kryptonians or something, and that makes sense because they have been here. They've set it up. That's canon in the DC cinematic universe.
Yeah.
Why not? I don't mind that. I think that's actually kind of cool.
Yeah, and it also helps, like, you know, bring everything together. So
right.
Now, we're not saying that's what's going to happen.
No, absolutely not.
I think it's a fascinating theory.
Yeah.
If DC wanted to find a way to try to grant, because they try to be the more grounded one. Okay, well, we've already introduced Kryptonians. 20,000 years, a Kryptonian landed here, established her own whatever, and that gene line, that genetic line, lineage, offshot to what we now have in the Amazonians, which would explain how somebody born on Earth can perhaps slug it out with Superman a little bit. Why there might be these undersea dwellers who can live down there in the... I mean, it would explain something. I still don't think that's what they're doing, but it would be really interesting.
Yeah. And last thing, I want to see Aquaman fight Superman in this movie. I know a lot of people are like, that script is fake. I'm not saying anything about any fake scripts. I'm just saying I would love to see that happen. I want to see some action sequence with Aquaman. If he's not riding a swordfish, he's fighting Superman.
Especially
I just want to see
if
that.
Underwater he's got heightened, you know, powers where you could believe he can go toe-to-toe. I mean, there might even be something to said that, like, the rays of the sun don't penetrate the depths of the oceans.
Damn.
So Superman is
his powers are weakened. All right, guys, let's move on to a thing I like to call minor mutations. It's just some news of the week. We're going to rock through this quick, and then we'll pick out the ones and talk a little bit about them. Number one, Herbie, our favorite robot, and the Fantastic Car designs were revealed by one of the artists who worked on the Fantastic Four movie before they cut all this cool stuff out. Number two, we got Hulk's not in Civil War, and it's about who governs the heroes with the Accords movement. So it's not the Registration Act, because basically in the Marvel cinematic world, everyone knows who Iron Man is, and everyone knows who Steve Rogers. So it's not about secret identities, but it's more about, it's almost who watches the Watchmen is basically what it's going to be like.
Right.
Number three, we've got Arrow and Gotham both have new trailers for their brand new seasons. Check those out. And a lot of cool stuff's going to be happening in both of those series. Liev Schreiber says he wants to be Wolverine 3 on The Tonight Show. He says he might be. He actually might be. He might be training. You know, he left a lot of bombs, you know, basically saying on The Tonight Show, he's pretty much going to be in it. You know, that's without, you know, he didn't say, no, I'm not doing it. So, and number five, we got Ron Perlman hinting at the Hellboy 3 script, the plot of it, basically telling us the entire plot of the movie, which I think was a good reason. So, I mean, it's a good thing to do because I don't know if they're ever going to make a Hellboy 3, so why not tell everybody, look what you're missing out on and get people angry that they're not going to get to see it. John, what pops out to you on this?
Well, I mean, we talked about movie talk. Yeah. The Perlman thing is almost irrelevant because it sounds cool to hear, but there's not going to be a Hellboy 3. I would love it if there is. I mean, who knows? But as things stand, there's just not going to be. I think the big thing on all that, what was the second last one
you were saying? Liev Schreiber.
Oh, yeah. I mean, that's the one. I mean, Hugh Jackman, and he started that Twitter conversation with each other. I mean, look, for everything, in a lot of bad movies, you could find elements that, hey, that could have been cool, that could have been cool. Like Phantom Menace, Darth Maul. There's something that was cool, and you could have done a lot of really cool things with Darth Maul. In that Wolverine origin film, or X-Men Origins Wolverine, there's a lot bad. But I think Sabretooth, played by Liev Schreiber, is one of those things, Creed, is one of those things that could have been really, really cool. Why not take one of the strongest things that you had in your movie so far, bring it back in, do something cool with it, have a true Wolverine versus Sabretooth movie, which is, I mean, really, that's his greatest foe.
Yeah.
That is his iconic main marquee foe is Sabretooth. Bring him in to do something like that again. I'd be all for it. And Liev Schreiber is just kick ass as an actor.
Yeah.
I could watch that dude in just about anything. So that's the story to me. That
I agree.
He
was definitely one of the highlights for Wolverine's origin. So what do you think?
Well, I mean, of the other things, you know, I don't mind that the Hulk is not going to be in Civil War, but it's interesting that they said they're saving why he's not in Civil War.
Right. Something big.
It's a big deal. Something perhaps they sent him away, mm-hmm. like in the Planet Hulk storyline, right. which would be badass. But, you know, I think what's more interesting is the Slovakia Accords. You know, they're really... I love the way the Marvel Cinematic Universe has tied itself all together. Everything... If you sit down for an afternoon and watch those movies, they hang together so well. Mm-hmm. And I think that's, you know, the reason that this has happened is because of what happened in Age of Ultron. I mean, Tony Stark created Ultron. Ultron runs amok and destroys a European or an Eastern Bloc country. Yeah. I mean, there are consequences, and I like that. You know, I like that they're tying it into all that. It makes sense, and there's a reason. I'm still on Tony Stark's side.
Yeah, I mean, they basically, you know, Ultron dropped a city. Could have killed, you know, hundreds of thousands of people and, in essence, the world. So Hulk not being in it makes sense to me because of the way Age of Ultron ended. And also Bruce Banner. I'm not 100% sold that Bruce Banner is not going to show up, like, on a video screen or something.
Sure.
You know, but I'm glad they're saving the Hulk for something bigger. So, you know, that's the way to do it. Let's move into a subject I like to call flashback, where we're going to talk about a movie from the past, a superhero film. This week, it's Unbreakable. M. Night Shyamalan's follow-up to The Sixth Sense was a superhero film that was more subtle than the recent Chronicle, wherein it told the story of real superheroes and supervillains actually existing in our real world, and even how they must be summoned by either the yin-yang or the villain-hero co-creating each other. That story, they really focused on Unbreakable with this story. Bruce Willis and Sam Jackson both turn in incredible performances. Let's talk about Unbreakable. What are your thoughts?
Right. I really love this movie. I mean, it was really unexpected to me. And in a way, it's sort of a Baroque science fiction movie and a Baroque superhero movie because it doesn't have any of the telltale signs of a superhero movie. Mm-hmm. It's a family drama in a way. Bruce Willis is a family man. And, you know, your supervillain is very sympathetic. Like it's almost like he doesn't really want to be a supervillain,
right.
but he's had this thrust upon him and he has to do it. It's almost like you pointed out, he's been summoned. And it's sort of sad. Like, he doesn't necessarily want to be put in this position. He didn't ask to be put in this position, but now that he's in this position, he's going to live up to the responsibility. You know, with great evil comes great responsibility.
Yeah, he's going
to
find the yang,
that evil.
Or the yin, whatever it is, he's going to find him.
And I really enjoyed it. I didn't know what to expect when I saw it. It was not as satisfying a movie as I thought it could be, mm-hmm. but it's very thought-provoking. You watch it again and again, and it just becomes better with time, I think.
John, what do you think?
It's the movie that proved that M. Night was not a one-trick pony, correct. And that he wasn't just a one-hit wonder, you know? I really like Unbreakable. It still today stands as the most unique of the superhero films. So unique so that you'd be forgiven to not even consider it a superhero film.
Right.
You know, and that's just how well he approached it. Like, what would it be like in the real world today if somebody actually had some kind of superhuman ability? And he approached it that way. I thought it was great. I was not thrilled with the conclusion of the film.
Yes.
It was a little bit too much. All right, now let me tell you everything that what really just happened.
Was it even typed out in hero font? I think
it
was like...
I mean, so I wasn't thrilled with that, but that was not enough to detract from overall how good the movie is.
Mm-hmm.
And it's one that... Who was it that just gave a pitch to M. Night for a sequel? So
it was Patton Oswalt.
Well, yeah, Patton Oswalt gave him the pitch. He had the other pitch. Here's a pitch to M. Night for how I think you could do Unbreakable 2, and I, for one, would be very interested in seeing it.
Yeah, I think Unbreakable is definitely, now that we're in the world of superheroes, that's like the grandpa of superhero films, and it's also a great double feature with Chronicle. You could watch both of those films, see Unbreakable first, then see Chronicle, and see the progression of the way these films, though not superhero-centric, they are about superheroes. For me, like, the only thing that detracted heavily was that ending, that freeze frame, and then years later, Dr. Glass is in prison, blah, blah, blah. I was like, what is this? And then there's credits? I got so angry that it kind of was, I was like, man, this movie's incredible. And then it became like a C, like it was like 75, because that last 2 minutes of the movie, like, brought me down so much that I was like, you really are going to end this amazing film this way with like a weird, like, to be concluded in text. I mean, it's one of my disappointments of that film, but if you just take that away, it's an incredible film. It really is all about character. It's all about story building and within the character.
The pacing is so good. It's one of the great films. Like, when I talk to people about what pacing means in a film, people just mean, oh, you mean it has to be fast, fast action? No. That's not what... Pace is cadence. Mm-hmm. Every movie has to find its own heartbeat, its cadence, and then flow within that cadence. And Unbreakable is one of the great examples of a movie that has such a great flow to
payoff.
It.
Payoff.
Yeah.
There's so much payoff when he's wearing that raincoat and he's standing... I think in Grand Central and just kind of like first kind of like, you know, getting little glimpses of people. And then he gets that one person who's like a murderer. And it's like, you're like, oh man, it's like, and you following with him as he's learning how to like, you know, be this person.
Well, in a way you talk about pacing. I mean, you think of superheroes as having to be rock and roll.
Right.
Whereas this is more jazz, you know, or classical.
Nice analogy. Yeah.
You know, I mean, it's like that. And it feels that way. And like you said, you've got these great iconic, I mean, that was a Batman moment, you know, that you're talking about, but it doesn't have to have that hit.
No.
We get it emotionally. You know, we're not getting told by visual effects or we're not getting told by a musical sting. We're actually feeling the emotion of the iconic imagery.
Right.
You know, you're feeling it. And that's something that's really hard to do.
So if you haven't seen Unbreakable, definitely check this movie out. It'll make you have a lot more respect for M. Night Shyamalan, for sure. It's a really fun film. Let's go on to Spotlight. This week, we are going to talk about a comic book called Irredeemable. This is written by Mark Waid. Most recently, he's been writing an incredible run on Daredevil, so definitely check that out. This is made a few years back. Mark Waid did basically a dark look on basically it's a what if Superman went bad. This story follows how hard and dangerous it would be to have to take down a character with Superman's power. This character is called the Plutonian. That's his name. And stay out of his way. Basically, this comic book series is just like, if Superman, the villains did a whole bunch of weird, messed up shit to him, and he went crazy, how hard it would be for the rest of the Justice League and every single other superhero, super-powered character, it would take everyone to not even take him down, but to hide. Basically, it's a fantastic series. You got to check it out. Robert, you've read it. What do you think?
I loved this series because what's really hard is to create new characters, new superheroes, new supervillains. This series has a whole pantheon. I mean, Mark Waid is one of the best, I think, comic writers of writing superhero comics today. Mm-hmm. I mean, he's so legendary. But this is also, not only does it have great superheroes and supervillains, it's great, it becomes very cosmic.
Yes.
You know, it goes out into there's even a prison that's inside a sun. Mm-hmm. Do you remember that? The prison inside the sun?
And it ends, too. That's one of these series that has
no spoilers, but doesn't it have one of the great kind of emotionally affecting, if you're a comic book fan and you like comic book history, the way this series ends kind of chokes you up. It kind of brings.
I like to say this goes on the wall with Miracle Man because he definitely
he
took elements from what Alan Moore brought to what if Shazam was a real character, kind of flipped it and skewed it a little bit to what if Superman was a real character, and went bad.
And you know it's Miracle Man 15, the battle in London. You know when the villain in Miracle Man is just putting people's heads on pikes. He's just murdering thousands.
He's
of people.
Insane.
He's insane and waiting for Miracle Man to show up. You know. This is kind of like that. I mean, you've got the Plutonian is killing millions of people. Mm-hmm. Like, he's wiping out cities. And it's bad.
It's incredible. I would love to see this as a movie. I think this would be an incredible film. You could also rock it as a TV series. It would have to be a little bit bigger budget. So somebody like Netflix, someone could rock Irredeemable very quickly. Get on it. All right, next we're going to move up into Twitter questions. This week we got Mitchell Claxton. Asks, any news about the Valiant Comics developments deal? Now that we know a Bloodshot movie is in the works. You guys heard anything else about any of these Valiant films like Shadow Man?
No.
Nothing.
Zero.
Absolutely nothing. And I have a very hard time believing those dates are going to be hit.
Now, I've heard Archer and Armstrong. I keep hearing about an Archer and Armstrong
movie. The only people I've heard attached are the guys who directed Wicked, John Wick.
Oh.
John Wick. So they're attached to Bloodshot. I don't know if that's going to happen, but you're right. It's been quiet. So We don't know what's going on with Valiant. Maybe we'll hear in the next couple weeks, and next year we'll hear some more news. Next question, Nicholas Kubites asks, do you think Shazam will be in the Justice League? Now, he's talking about the movie version.
Right.
Do you guys think, I mean, we've heard that The Rock is playing Black Adam for like the last like 48 years or something. I don't know, it seems like forever we've heard of, The Rock's going to play Black Adam. Well, okay, he's the villain. Who, A, is going to play Shazam? When are they making this movie? How are they going to introduce Shazam into the DC universe?
I don't see Shazam being a part of the DC universe, only because his powers are magically based, right. You know, given to him by the gods. I just don't see it fitting in. And, I mean, once you open the door to Shazam, is Mr. Mixelplick far behind?
Oh, I know.
Like, I don't know. I don't know if you would bring in Shazam. I mean, I love Shazam. I think he's one of the most classically designed superheroes. I love his costume. I love the red and then the white cape with the gold. But I just think that character is so unto itself. You know what I could see it being? The Ant-Man of the DC Cinematic Universe. Mm-hmm. They could do a Shazam movie the same way Ant-Man worked. Make it humorous, funny, family-oriented.
I guess, but if it's part of the same universe, I myself also have these same issues with Shazam. One of the reasons I loved Miracle Man is because it took all of the bad things that are Shazam,
right,
and made it somehow make sense in the real world. That sciencing it, they basically were like, "Let's get rid of these weird gods and these other weirdos and make it like when he says Komoda, which is the opposite of atomic. When he says the magic word, like just like Shazam, the little boy or whoever it is gets replaced with this crazy superhero. Where does the little person go, or where does the man go in Miracle Man? He's in a floating like dimension of like all these other bodies where it's set on another alien world where they're like, yeah, we replace our bodies all the time. If I want to be this creature that, you know, then I have like 30 extra bodies. You know?
And Kingdom Come did a great job of reinventing Shazam.
Yes.
You know, Mark Waid.
Yeah.
And
so, I mean, I'm not going to argue myself out of saying Shazam doesn't belong in the DC cinematic world, but they would have to approach it like Kingdom Come. And if DC was like, hey, we're going to set this 10 movie series or 12 movie series up, maybe even more. I don't know when they do like 3 Batmans along with all these other Justice League movies, it could be like 12 or 15 movies. But if they move it towards Kingdom Come to like, you know, in 10 or 15 years, or let's say 10 years, by 2025, we are seeing Kingdom Come.
I mean, that would be their Infinity War.
Yeah, that is the Infinity War for Justice League. That would, you know, I don't know if they would call it Justice League Kingdom Come or whatever, but that would be a smart move. Also, that's the way to reintroduce Shazam, by the villain holding some kind of power over.
Right.
What do you think, John?
Well, I mean, there's a couple of things to keep in mind here. I had a theory that when they first announced Shazam a long time ago, that this would be the one WB DC-based film that would not be in the Superman-Batman cinematic universe. That it would be its own cinematic universe. And I, for one, was hoping for that. Now, I've read some comments since that seem to suggest I was wrong about that, and that's unfortunate. It has always struck me as odd that if you're not doing Shazam until 2018 or 2019, whatever, why the hell are you announcing Dwayne The Rock Johnson as the villain of the film 5 years in advance?
Yeah.
What's going on? The only plausible explanation is that they plan that while that may be when the Shazam movie's coming, they must have plans to use him beforehand. There is another theory going around out there that I am not against, which is, since Black Adam and Shazam basically are based on the same power, a lot of people suggested that The Rock could be playing both. They've only announced Black Adam, but he could be playing Black Adam and Shazam at the same time. That would be interesting to see. I personally could totally be wrong on this. I'm not willing to bet any money on this. I believe we will see Shazam in Justice League Part 1. I do believe we're going to see him there. It just doesn't make sense to, like I said, have Rock announce The Rock 2 years ago when the movie's not coming out until 6 years after it. They had to have another plan.
And if they do introduce Shazam or Captain, they can't call him Captain Marvel.
No, his name in the comic book now is officially Shazam.
Right, so it's that just keeps reminding me of that Shaquille O'Neal movie. What was that one called?
Oh,
Kazam?
Kazam.
Oh, Kazam. Kazam. No, not Steel, the other bad movie that he was in. I don't see how they're, what are they going to do with Shazam? They have to retrofit his entire origin. They can't use the origin.
No.
It just doesn't make sense, especially with the way the DC cinematic universe is working.
Well, wait a minute. I mean, like, the way it's working so far, but there's a lot of unanswered questions here. Like, we don't know what is the origin of the Amazonians. If it is the mythical Greek gods,
right,
they're opening big new doors.
Sure, that's
like,
true.
I mean, so I mean, that could totally.
She's made of clay. Is Aquaman like Poseidon? You're right.
I mean, it could also be all connected.
I mean, to bring it back to Star Trek, the Greek gods in Star Trek, the Roman gods, were shown in an episode called "Who Mourns for Adonais?"
Right.
About you had Apollo was an alien.
Yeah.
So what if the gods of Olympus were in fact Kryptonians? Mm. You know, if they're going to bring that in, that they seeded the Earth or something, sure. Or all this is an offshoot of Kryptonian technology, which would kind of be cool because they set that up in Man of Steel that they were colonizing
makes,
whole world.
Actually makes total sense, and then they can explain away the Greek mythology as like, ah, that's Poseidon, he's also King Arthur, also, you know, King of Atlantis.
Right, which would be kind Aquaman. Of, and then I think you're right, because then they could tie the origin of Shazam right back in to the Kryptonian history.
Yeah. Right.
But then again, how does that work with the Saturday morning TV show where Mentor and Billy Batson are
that's right.
driving around the highways and byways of the land in their Winnebago?
Yeah, if you haven't checked those out, watch it on YouTube.
Warner Archives. Yeah,
it's so much fun. Just check it out. They're just driving around in a van. What's going on over here? Shazam!
And then the animated Greek gods would show up.
That's right.
Some talk.
Some big problems. Let's move on to the next question. We got Luke Robinson asking, what are your thoughts on the film Spawn? Modern special effects could make such a great remake. Well, now, we covered Spawn many, many weeks ago on an episode of Heroes. Not exactly one of my favorite movies. Very uneven. I liked the original idea of the comic book. I liked Todd McFarlane's like crazy kind of dark gothic artwork. Unfortunately, he just never wrote it correctly. It just never kind of clicked off for me. And then he had a bunch of other guest writers come on and a bunch of other people like Neil Gaiman came on, added to his universe. And then it just became kind of stale to me. It's just like, you know, what is Al Simmons going to be doing? You know, he's trying to get his soul back from hell. You got this other weird creature with a big jaw. I don't know. I mean, I know
Malabogia.
Yeah, Malabogia. So it's like, what do you think, Robert?
I really dislike the Spawn movie, like intensely. It was one of those movies where I felt someone was kicking me in the face for 90 minutes.
Yeah.
I mean, the tone was all over the place. It didn't work. I like the idea of this character from hell,
mm-hmm.
like that has to redeem himself somehow, and his ex-wife and the family that he never had. But it was too, the idea of the creatures like the Malabogia or Angela was too, tonally, it was always all over the place.
Right.
And there was some good storylines when he would bring in like Neil Gaiman or Frank Miller or somebody, and it would be interesting.
Those are like one shots.
One, yeah.
I mean, the thing's 200 issues, and he's like, I picked up a couple randomly over the course of the last like 20 years. Yeah, it was just always like. Yeah.
What I did appreciate, though, you got to go back when the Image universe started, or the Image Comics imprint started. I did appreciate how Todd McFarlane kept that comic coming out consistently.
Oh yeah.
And then he started his toy company, and the original Spawn action figures were terrific.
Sure. I mean, his toy division is completely separate from what I think. Like him and Eric Larson were the only ones who were like consistently putting out. Eric Larson beat him by a long shot. Eric right. Larson's Savage Dragon, great. Always fun, always every issue he's been putting it out. I think it's like over 200 issues now. I had the first 100, then I just got all the trades. So it's sort of like, I think, you know, the Image guys really had a lot going for them, what they were trying to do, and a lot of them did so much. Look at Jim Lee's running DC Comics now. I mean, Todd McFarlane, sure, he had a bunch of weird baseball fetishism, bought a bunch of balls for $2 million. I don't know if he lost his money. Maybe he's still a millionaire. I don't know what's going on with him. He still has Todd McFarlane toys coming out. He's still printing Spawn. He's still saying eventually they're going to make a Spawn movie.
And the Spawn animated series was really
Spawn,
cool.
The animated series, once again, though, you know, that broke new ground. It was really fun. It was cool. We're like, you know, that was 20 years ago. We're sort of like, when is the second Spawn going to come out? Put your money where your mouth is. You can make a Spawn movie for $1 million. You know, you don't need to make, you know, you don't have to have $40 million for a Spawn movie. Especially, he wants to go horror film style. So make it like a Blumhouse Spawn, and there you go. What do you think, John?
Well, you hear McFarlane say that, oh, trust me, another Spawn movie is coming. It just sounds like Tom Arnold saying for 20 years, we're going to do another True Lies. True Lies 2 is coming, all that. No, I mean, the first one was a mess, despite the fact that, you know, President Bartlett was in it, apparently, at one thing. John Leguizamo as the Violator was kind of that one possibly redeemable thing about it. But honestly, I'm just at the point, I have no interest in a new Spawn movie. I think there's a lot of people right now, there's a whole generation now of comic book readers who never read Spawn.
Right.
It's too little, too late. If you do something now, it's going to have to be a micro, like, maybe $8 million film.
Yeah.
I I just don't see a reality where you can do one that have people interested.
I would just basically like just wholesale rip off Sinister and make it Spawn instead of the Boogeyman. I mean, it's literally like, just make it a horror film. I wouldn't maybe have the kids doing that thing. Just go with, you know, maybe have like a clown, the Violator. You could do some cool stuff with it, but really, I would try to keep it really low budget and not go back to basics, but go in a different route, the route that McFarlane's always telling us he's going with, which is like a horror film, and maybe Spawn would be almost like a crypt keeper telling stories or something. I don't know what he's going
to
do with it.
Yeah, I wanted Spawn to be like The Crow. I thought The Crow is still to this day one of my very favorite comic adaptations.
Fun film.
And because the tone was consistent. You know, it had a fantastical element to it, a man coming back from the dead. It's very similar to Spawn, but it doesn't have the crazy creatures, and The Crow really worked, whereas Spawn just, the last half of that film was unbearable.
Yeah, it's a pretty much of a bad film. Let's call it what it is. All right, let's move on. We've got The Dark Knight writing us. Could we have multiple timelines in the DCU just like in the best Justice League comics and The Flash show? That'll be awesome. So in the DCU, he's talking about the DCEU, the extended universe or whatever.
I still refuse to call it that.
I know, the extended. It's like, all right, let's just call what it is. The movie version universe or whatever you want to call it. So, say cinematic universe. It's what's so bad universe, about that? Yeah. They're like, we don't want to copy Marvel. Relax. So what do you guys think? I mean, it's like if they are going to introduce, like we know in the Flash series, there are multiple universes. We're seeing a Flash. The Jay Garrick Flash with a weird metallic helmet. That's pretty awesome. I haven't seen the episode yet, but I was like, when I saw that image, I was like, A, that's cool that they're taking a cover from the original 60s Flash comic book where the Flash of Two Worlds, they did an exact replication of that for the actual TV series, just as like a little tip of the hat to comic sweaties out there. We're like, all right, look, if the TV series is going to be this awesome, you got to step up the game. Is the DC universe cinematically going to open up that world? What do you think, John?
I hope not. I really hope not. To me, this is not to say that there are not some examples of good uses of this device. There absolutely are. But a lot of time when comics lost me is when they got into 17 different timelines, Earth 1, 2, 3 through 77, alternate realities this and blah, blah, blah. It's lazy. I'll call it what it is. It's lazy. It's not being able to come up with it. Like, how many times do we have to see movies do time travel to fix things too? I mean, there are examples of it being done great, Star Trek IV, but there are also plenty and plenty and plenty of examples of it's just not worth doing. I don't like multiple timelines, multiple universes, multiple whatever. You know, Paradox is like becomes an example of, hey, this is an example where it actually worked. There are examples of what worked. But what really frustrates me a lot of times is when filmmakers or storytellers or fans will point to the 1 out of 50 that worked and just pretend like the other 49 don't exist. Right. You know, I hope they don't. I want one consistent timeline, one consistent universe, and tell your stories within it. That's what I would like to see. But again, I'm open that if they try something like that, that there are examples of it working, so maybe it'll be one of those. I just don't think the chances are high.
I agree with you. I mean, it's hard enough to get one universe right. Let's get one DC Cinematic Universe right, which, by the way, the jury is still out on. I think, as we've said, I can't wait for Suicide Squad. I can't wait for Batman v Superman. I'm Dawn of Justice. I can't wait. But again, let's see if it works. I mean, this whole idea, I love the fact that they just think that, well, Marvel worked, so we must, DC's got to work. I mean, you got to build. You got to build that stuff. You can't just assume that you're going to make kind of like what happened at Sony with the Spider-Man universe. Well, we're going to build that Spider-Man universe. Where's that Sinister Six movie?
Right.
I don't know.
Right. Where's the Aunt May movie?
It's just I just think that let's make one movie at a time and let's make it great. And having a multiverse, why? Why? We don't need one.
Yeah.
I agree. I mean, my last thing about any of these multiple universes is, I don't know how many years ago now, Crisis on Infinite Earths came out.
85, 86.
85, 86. The reason that they did that was because they had too many universes. They were like, we've got Earth H, we've got Earth 2, 4, 11.
And they had acquired like the Charleston characters. They
all
had
these different characters. So they did that. Why? To merge it into one universe where all the stories can intertwine and make sense. Now, Marvel has done that and DC have done that ad infinitum now. To the point where they do it every year. They do it every year. They reboot their comic book universes every year. Now, we've heard about the new 52. Now there's like another additional side 52 with an additional rebooting sauce of this added. It gets to the point where you're like, I can see why comics aren't selling anymore.
And because Secret they're Wars ruining and Battle World. I mean, with the Marvel
what
universe.
I'm trying to say is they're ruining the fun experience of reading comic books. Now, if Marvel and DC were smart, at least to me, they would just close down shop for a month and stop publishing all of these like 500 different versions of different universes and this and that, and all these things that are all tying in. Their comics are $4.99 each. So it's like you've got to think about fans who are going in and buying comics every week. Wouldn't you want them to just buy 3 comics every week? That would be 12 titles a month. Why don't you just make 12 incredible titles a month? I'm not trying to say like fire all these other people. You know, I'm just saying it's like keep your pocket weirdo universes, but try launching a brand new one that's just like these 12 titles all sink in. They're all, you don't have to buy all of them. They're all separate stories. Here's Batman, here's Superman, here's Justice League, here's Wonder Woman. And just get really good creative teams on it and don't have these multiple universe things. It just is really, I mean, like what you're talking about with the television or movie world, it's even worse with comic books because there's just too many tie-ins and it just separates fans. It ruins it. It drowns it out. You have committees like trying to figure out how we're going to make all of these different titles tie in together. How about a good story?
But you're also getting a multiverse on TV now.
Yes.
So why do you need one on the big screen?
You don't.
I mean, if they do Legends of Tomorrow, right, who knows who's going to show up? I mean, you've got Rip Hunter and Vandal Savage and God knows where they've been.
You've got a time travel show on TV. I mean, it would be a horrible idea to have the Flash show up, like the future Flash, like, come with me, Darkseid's ruining the future from 5 years from now.
Or Monarch. That, Monarch shows up.
All right, let's move on. We've got a couple last questions going on. Mr. Undecillion asks, do you think it's possible in today's age for a movie studio to make a film based on Howard Chaykin's Black Kiss? Now,
yeah, Vivid Entertainment.
Yeah. Kids, if you haven't ever heard of Black Kiss or Howard Chaykin, we had talked about him a couple shows ago. He's one of the creators, a writer, artist of American Flag. Now, that's
one of the greatest
comic book series ever published. Buy the first 25 issues or get the trade paperbacks. It's an amazing, fun story told in a future time with these Plexus Rangers. I don't even want to go into how awesome it is.
It's awesome.
Just get it, buy
Art
it, read
awesome.
It.
Art is awesome. Ken Brusniak's lettering.
Howard Chaykin's been around the block for a long time before he did American Flag and then got some notoriety and then busted out this crazy black and white series that were like shrink wrapped. I remember buying these when I was like 19.
Yeah,
I
was it
like,
was all
oh
shrink wrapped.
It is some X-rated stuff. It is like super X-rated crime noir. Crazy.
Hollywood crime noir.
Hollywood crime noir. So I would see this as like a really hardcore kind of like one-shot movie.
We should also say that if you're going to go look up this series, please, if you're younger, this has to be parental. This is an X-rated comic book.
It is X-rated.
It's
so.
X-rated.
You know, put your Google alerts on or whatever, and you won't be able to see anything.
I loved it, though. I thought it was a really interesting story. But, you know, clearly, I heard Chaykin was going through a divorce when he wrote this comic.
Oh, wow.
Man, I mean, talk about... This comic is angry. There is a level of misogyny in this comic. And
it's crazy.
There is there's just a lot of anger here. And I'm a huge Chaykin fan. I mean, he was back in the day when he was doing, like, The Shadow for DC. He was doing Black Hawk for DC. He was doing, I mean, American Flag was awesome.
This was like a weird aberration. Then he did Times Squared, remember?
Times Squared, which is kind of an offshoot of, sort of.
There's a lot of stuff that was like, Times Squared, I definitely say, is like, it's not hardcore like Black Kiss, but also has, like, similar elements.
Yes, it does. But recently he released Black Kiss 2 last couple of years. But I don't think, to make a movie of this, I think it would be cool. I think it'd be cool to do it in black and white, but it'd be NC-17.
It would have to be.
And it probably would have a hard time finding an audience.
Yeah.
I don't know if anybody would go
I think
see
it would have
it.
A hard time finding an audience.
It's
but
not
going to
come
out
from Marvel anytime
Never
soon.
Never heard of it, check out Black Kiss. Let's move on. We got Clark asking, what storyline would you want for the Aquaman standalone? What do you think will happen? You guys have any ideas? John, you were mentioning the Aquaman storyline that you read in the comics.
Yeah, no, which is very cool, but I don't think any of it really fits in with what they're doing here. And in this, I think you go, this is a new Aquaman. This is what we've seen in Jason Momoa. This is not an Aquaman we've seen in any of the comics before. So I'm sure what they will probably end up doing is borrow story elements from several of the big things, but I don't think you're going to see a direct Civil War adaptation story. Because even in the modern cinematic universe, even when they call it Civil Civil War. It ain't Civil War. It isn't what you read in the comics.
No.
Winter Soldier, that ain't Winter. Days of Future Past, don't think you're going to pick up the comic book and read what you saw on the
movie
screen.
Not even close.
So I think what they're going to do is do something totally unique, totally new, and borrow some story ideas from several maybe popular ones.
Yeah, I mean, I loved when I think it was in the Flashpoint universe when the Atlanteans and the Amazonians were at war, destroying the world. I mean,
that's
That's
right.
But I think that I would like to see, I think that if there's got to be, the Atlanteans are in conflict with us. You know, you could do a good movie about the fate of the world hangs in the balance, tie in global warming, give it an ecological message, but, you know, do something where something that would have real world import. You know, I don't think the problem with Aquaman is once he leaves the water, what does he do? You know, you've got to.
Well, they address that in New 52.
They do.
Quite a
they
bit.
Do.
Yeah.
They do.
I like the angry Aquaman. Remember, it's 75% of the world is water.
It's his.
And it's his, and we're ruining it with dumping, pollution.
Right.
There's
a lot
of stuff.
That's
where
I think that's where your movie comes from.
That is the movie.
What if the Atlanteans want to exterminate the surface dwellers?
Yeah, they're like, you're the reason for global warming. We're not doing anything. We're underwater. Be like, that's, you know.
You're out.
Yeah. That's a big fight for the rest of the Justice League.
I mean, that would be really interesting.
All right, let's move on. Ray DeJesus asks, will the failure of Fantastic Four for three times over now, do you think Marvel will get the rights to Dr. Doom and make him the new villain after Thanos? Do you think that's possible?
Well, just you got to remember, a lot of people are confused about how these rights things work. It's not like Marvel can just go, oh, we want them back now. Thank you. That's just not how it works. As long as Fox keeps making and keeps developing Fantastic Four movies, they keep the rights to all of them. And I don't think Marvel's about to just give back individual characters.
Fox.
And, you know, what's Doctor Doom without the Fantastic Four? I mean, he's a great character that can be used in many scenarios. I'm not saying he can't, but he is also very synonymous with Fantastic Four in many ways. Like I said earlier in the show, if Fox is not going to overhaul the way they're approaching this altogether, this will be the first situation where I'm actually going to say I believe Fox should just throw up the flag and say, look, we give up. Do what they did with Daredevil. Say, we give up. We're just not going to develop it and let the rights lapse back to Marvel. But I don't know if Fox is going to be willing to do that or not. Right. I hope they do.
A Fantastic Four TV series could be really interesting. Mm-hmm. Netflix that, make it like Daredevil. Not like Daredevil, but if that could be an approach that could work. I mean, more of a domestic drama. I don't know.
Yeah, like a CW-style Fantastic Four. Get more into the relationships with the actual Fantastic Four.
You look at The Incredibles. You look at Brad Bird's The Incredibles. That was essentially a Fantastic Four movie.
It was all about family, really.
And, Doom, I don't think... First of all, Thanos, you can't follow up Thanos with Doctor Doom.
No, and also you can't separate Doctor Doom from Fantastic Four. No. It doesn't really work that way. Let's move on. Next question is Cody Q-Ball4 asks, will Lex Luthor lose his hair due to kryptonite poisoning in Batman vs. Superman? We know he's bald. We've seen the photos. And then in all of the trailers, he's got that long Jesse Eisenberg hair. What do you think?
I think it's a wig. I think he's bald all along.
Right.
And I think it's gonna turn. Because remember, they actually have done that before with Lex Luthor with Gene Hackman.
Yes.
That he had hair. He didn't lose it. It was a wig. I think they might do that again.
What do you think?
I completely agree.
Right on. I'm gonna just for the heck of it say maybe it's kryptonite poisoning. But
it makes sense. I mean, you see the body of Zod.
Yeah. Or it's a wig. You know, either way. all right, next question. John Burnett asks, Schnepp, will we ever see a Jerry Bruckheimer, Michael Bay led comic book movie? Probably not Jerry Bruckheimer, but Michael Bay, he's already, you know, he's toying around with it. He's like produced Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, which is a comic book franchise. Those are superheroes.
Yes, it is.
They are turtles, but they count as superheroes.
And I surprisingly liked it.
I did too. I have to say, I found the movie. I know everyone's going to hate on us, but it was fun. What do you think, Robert?
Why not? I mean, I remember there was an idea that Michael Bay would direct a Superman movie at some point.
Oh, was that bounce around?
And I was like, are you kidding me? That would be awesome. I would love to see the Armageddon version of Superman.
That's right.
Like, the thing about I don't hate on Michael Bay. Like, some people do. Like, look, I will defend Transformers Dark of the Moon. I love the Battle of Chicago. I love Armageddon. It's a total guilty pleasure. I like The Rock.
Oh, The Rock is awesome.
I like Bad Boys. I even like Bad Boys 2, as overblown and ridiculous as it was. I mean, I think that Michael Bay doing a movie where Darkseid is the villain, you know, and we could see some massive battle of somebody doing something to someone. I mean, the Transformers movies are essentially superhero movies with the Transformers as superheroes.
So you just see endless butt shots of Wonder Woman.
I was going to say, can you imagine be like, what the Wonder Woman outfit would look like if Michael Bay were directing Wonder Woman?
But it would be, I mean, look, I think he would bring the action quotient up. He would make some apocalyptic, there would be some incredible action stuff. I'd love to see what he would do. And you know, I'll tell you something, Pain and Gain, if you guys haven't seen Pain and Gain, great movie.
Yeah,
I thought he did a phenomenal job. It was him making a movie for $25 million or however much that cost. Right. And yet it still was Michael Bay, but it really, really worked. He had a really good script. And I think that, again, if you're Michael Bay and you're being given all that money to make Transformers movies and blow stuff up, why would you stop doing that? Did you see his house that he had custom designed?
Can we blow it up?
No, but it's it's pretty awesome. And I just think that, I don't know, don't blow that house up. I'd rather live in it someday. But I why not? I'd love to see a Michael Bay superhero movie.
I don't know. You know, for me, Transformers 4 was such horrendous garbage.
It was. Well, so was 2. 2 and 4 were really
tough.
The only
Transformers 4 movie that I liked was Dark Side of the Moon, or whatever that old version was called. You know, that was at least kind of fun. And I think partially because I lived in Chicago for 12 years, it was fun to see Michigan Avenue get blown up by Transformers.
The first one was good until the incoherent battle at the end.
Yeah.
Like, where are they and
Yeah, I really liked the first one, and I thought the last three were total garbage. And but you know, whatever. Michael Bay, you listed off a lot of films that a lot of people forget that he has made some good films.
Yes. Yeah.
You know, and what he's doing with the Transformers right now, I don't know what he's thinking or what he's doing, but it's making the money, and that's all they care about. I can't see a Michael Bay fitting in the Marvel Cinematic Universe. I can't see a Michael Bay fitting in what it seems like they're trying to set up and design in the Warner Brothers DC Cinematic Universe. So is it possible? Sure, but it would have to be something new that we haven't seen yet outside of the Marvel and DC thing.
I just thought of it. Give Michael Bay all of the Valiant characters.
Well, I was going to say that, too.
Let him run. If not Valiant, let him run some other pocket universe of characters who haven't been exploited yet, and let Bay put his, like, Explodo touch on
All right, how about this? Michael Bay does the Fantastic Four. Does the John Byrne, Jack Kirby, Stan Lee Fantastic
Four. Can you imagine
Four?
The online outrage? If
I don't mind it.
Dude,
no, wait
come
a minute,
on.
Though. But imagine, can you imagine, though, what the narrative will be? What the narrative will be tomorrow online.
Right.
If they announce, okay, Fox, we are moving ahead with Fantastic Four 2, and we've brought on a highly successful director, because whatever you think of Michael Bay, you cannot take away that he is successful.
No.
Highly successful director, Michael Bay. The internet will break. The internet will break.
I so desperately want the internet to break.
I do too. I
like it.
I do too, man.
It's like, what do you want, Tommy Wiseau or Michael Bay? I'm
well,
like, give me.
Well, if you
me,
that's my
you
options.
Know what? Give me
Michael
Bay.
Michael Bay would just strut on in. He'd tell Emma at Fox, Emma, I got
that's
this.
Right.
And
Emma, why don't
her
you sit down for a little bit?
Yeah,
why don't
you
take a break?
Michael Bay is going to walk
why
in
you have a soda?
And save the Fantastic. You know what? Why? Because if you look at Armageddon, a guilty pleasure, to be sure.
I unabashedly love Armageddon.
If you look at what he does, he builds his team.
Mm-hmm.
The way he does the team building in that, how you meet all those characters. If Michael Bay Armageddon's the team, Armageddon's the Fantastic Four, and puts all those people in it, and you know he has Silver Surfer, he has. Can you imagine Michael Bay's version of Galactus?
It'd be insane.
And it would be dope.
I know Michael Bay would not give Dr. Doom electrical powers.
No,
I just know he wouldn't.
No, I mean it would. It
I
would,
don't. I don't know that he
no,
would.
He'll
say,
give
I honestly don't.
I'm half joking. Everyone. Gets,
I mean, I think a Michael Bay Fantastic Four movie would be great because he's really good with those characters, taking that team, putting it together, and it would be colorful and it would be gigantic.
I'm going to keep
and
this
cosmic.
As a. I don't know if I could 100% get behind this, but I like it as a joke slash. I let's just say Michael Bay is directing the Fantastic Four. Like,
yes.
I'm serious. Just
let that sink in for a minute.
Let that sink in. Michael Bay is now directing the next Fantastic Four movie. So just let that sink in. And we're going to move on to our last question before we get to the sweaty question. Eric Fritsch says, with Warner Brothers wanting to make a new Batman trilogy, hell yeah, thoughts on including a Batman Beyond storyline in there? Absolutely
no.
not.
No.
No.
Yeah. No. Can we all just say
no?
Nobody wants it. Just let it go.
Leave it alone. Go away. You already have the fan. You had Batman Beyond animated series. You had a couple of movies. You even had one of the better animated movies. It was The Joker, The Return of the Joker, within the Batman Beyond franchise, where you got a little flavor from the original animated series. You had a freaked out Robin. You had the darkest Joker ever performed by Mark Hamill. That's where it ends. Look, if you want to make a Batman Beyond live action movie, I'm not going to hate on it, but just don't include it into the Batman trilogy. It has nothing to do with it.
I agree, but you know what? I think a Batman Beyond standalone movie could be kind of really cool if it was done in a Blade Runner-esque Matrix Dark City fashion, took place in that kind of a future, and you had a, you know, really old Bruce Wayne, bring Christian Bale back to play old Bruce Wayne.
If it was in conjunction with other Batman movies, I have zero problem with it. If it's going to replace a new Batman movie.
No, absolutely not. But look, I'm loving the way Affleck is looking in Batman v Superman.
I mean, it's theirs.
When
to
he's
throw
running
away.
After that building, when he runs to the collapsing building and not away from the collapsing building, I'm like,
craziness.
That's Bruce Wayne.
All right. But here's the thing. Look, I've said this before. I will say this again. The people who watch Batman Beyond are such an infinite, finite, small number. It's crazy.
Slightly more people than read comics.
Yes,
but still,
that
that was a very good series.
It was.
Yes, but,
it was fun.
But it lasted, what, two seasons? It was either two or three, that was it. There's a reason there wasn't seasons 4, 5, and 6.
Right.
Because even for them, they didn't have the numbers to justify keep going on with it. Look, when the average person thinks Batman, they think Bruce Wayne. Bruce Wayne is Batman. Batman is not just a title. That's Bruce Wayne. It is the story of Bruce Wayne. The average film goer would not care one spit about a Batman Beyond story.
They'd be like, why is he in the future? It'd be so many questions for the first 20 minutes. No one would be able to pay attention to Batman
unless
Beyond.
You start with, you know, the old Bruce Wayne.
Exactly. That would be the way to lead in. You know, it's Ben Affleck in like in 10 years. Oh, let's do
and
that
that's not
Beyond.
Us telling anybody that you shouldn't like the animated series. I'm not, that's not a comment on the quality of the animated series whatsoever.
No,
it's just that it doesn't translate.
Like I said, I wouldn't mind them doing it. Do a one shot, or even like, but let's get the Batman, Ben Affleck. That's exciting. So, all right, sweaty question of the week. It's Michael Martinez. Do you think Marvel would ever be brave enough to adapt the Demon in a Bottle storyline for Iron Man 4, maybe? So, this is one of the more famous comic book storylines written by Dave Michelin, drawn by Bob Layton, where Tony Stark becomes an alcoholic and has a serious problem, not only as Tony Stark, but as Iron Man, even functioning like a real human being. He's an alcoholic in a comic book series. You hear about these comic books that were like transformative and talked about issues. You always hear about like Green Lantern and
Green Arrow.
Green Arrow, the drug, the heroin.
My ward Speedy is a junkie.
It's
Denny O'Neill. Denny O'Neill cover when he's injecting himself with heroin.
It's Neil Adams. You know, that was his run. He put Green Lantern on the map and then later Batman. It's like you get these comic books that are, you know, are issue comics. They're like
they were very much a product of the 70s.
Totally. So this is an 80s issue where you're like dealing with something that a lot of people have issues and are having problems with all the time. You have AA, it's like it's Alcoholics Anonymous. Iron Man became an alcoholic. They've kind of gone a little bit back and forth in the Iron Man movie, specifically Iron Man 2, where he's like loaded at that one party. He's like drank way too much with the Iron Man outfit on, blowing stuff up.
And fights War Machine.
Yeah, and War Machine has to take him down. So it's like, what do you guys think about them actually pushing that forward into what Iron Man 4 or 5 and 6, whatever the Iron Mans can be if Tony Stark, i.e. Robert Downey Jr., continues playing him? What do you think, John?
No, they won't do it. And like you said, we talked about a little bit before that sometimes these superhero movies will take story elements from various popular storylines, bring them in. And they already did that with Iron Man 2.
Right.
Here's the problem. One of the issues, I quite enjoyed Iron Man 3. I had fun with Iron Man 3. Mm-hmm. But one of the things that a lot of people complained about was the fact that they shouldn't have called it Iron Man 3. They should have called it Tony Stark 3 and you know stuff like that because you didn't see a lot of Iron. There is now an expectation set up amongst fans about what they want to get when they go to an Iron Man film. And there's nothing wrong with that. That's perfectly fine. That Demon in a Bottle is not something that lends itself to that. I don't think you're going to find that most of those $1 billion worth of people who went to see Iron Man 3 or whatever, I think you're going to find that a lot of them aren't interested in seeing a human drama play out for 2 hours of Tony Stark wrestling with alcoholism. Look, when the first Iron Man was coming out and they announced it, I was one of those guys online going, I hope they do Demon in a Bottle. That would be so cool.
Me too.
But they didn't. They gave us a great Iron Man movie. And what they did is they set a tone for these are what our movies are. Mm-hmm. These are what our movies do. And to bring in, it's not a question of are they brave enough. It would be are they dumb enough? Because that Iron Man movie, while it might be really cool to watch, I'll be there opening day, damn right. But that movie ain't going to make $1 billion. It's not what the Marvel audience is expecting or what they want right now, or they don't want that kind of a story. So I just don't think it's likely.
Also, I would say in Iron Man 3, they dealt with Tony Stark. I mean, his demons were
PTSD
that,
now.
You know, PTSD and his demons were that after New York, everything changed.
Right.
He didn't know, like, he was an industrialist inventor. Now he's dealing with alien invasions and cosmic. He's going to find out that Thanos is going to come gunning for all of them. And I think that we saw a version in a way of the Demon in a Bottle storyline in Iron Man 3.
Yeah.
It just, look, let's face it. I mean, do we want, like you just said, do we want to see our heroes descend into alcoholism and drug abuse in the context of these films? I mean, look, it was great when you're reading comics because you never saw that before. Mm-hmm. They never dealt with that kind of an issue with a main character. You know, but I just don't think that it's really, parents don't want to see that. The kids don't want to see that. And while it's an element of real life, I think it's just a little too real for the Marvel Cinematic Universe. They dealt with things like that in interesting ways. You know, I think showing their guilt and showing, I think we're going to see more of that in Civil War.
I think, you know, they're dealing with Tony's guilt in many ways. And I think they've already kind of started the Demon in the Bottle over the course of all three Iron Man movies and transforming still into all these other, like his appearance in the Avengers and Avengers Age of Ultron. Remember, he's the one who created what's supposed to be the shield that protects Earth from aliens. That's called Ultron. So it's his fault.
Right.
I think also Civil War is going to deal with a lot of things, not only that are his fault in Age of Ultron, but ramifications there and afterwards, like team control. Is it Cap or is it Iron Man? I think him hitting the bottle, I think they're going to expand on that, but they're just not going to make it Demon in the Bottle. It's not going to be the main storyline. I would love to see them announce Iron Man 4, 5, and 6 and have that be a kind of a thread to pull us through that series. You could even make this the fifth Iron Man, like the Empire Strikes Back, the darkest one where he's Iron Man. You know he's going to come back. You know he's going to beat whatever it is. And he's going to have to beat the creature looking back at him in the mirror. That's himself. That's what anybody who deals with any kind of drug issues, albeit smoking cigarettes, drinking alcohol, doing drugs, any of these creatures, these habits that people develop and they're really hard to beat, eventually you get to beat them.
And I think as we get into Civil War, what we're going to see, I love your analogy about how he's kind of already dealing with the Demon in the Bottle, so mm-hmm. through these other expressions. I think what we're going to find is when we get into Civil War that the whole reason Tony Stark is siding with the government, is siding with the Accords, is that unbearable guilt.
Yeah.
He's already feeling guilty over the events of the first Avengers. Now he's going to be bearing the guilt of what happened in Ultron. Mm-hmm. And I think we're going to see that express itself just in a different way than what we saw in the comic books.
Yeah, and if he expresses by turning more to the bottle, that could also be, I just don't see that as the story.
It's also not big enough for a movie.
No.
They've gone too big. I mean, you can deal with personal choices and personal dilemmas, which they did so well in Ant-Man. I mean, that was a really interesting way to personalize a story. I mean, a father wanting to get back to his family, and it wasn't unbearable, and it fit within the context of the movie.
Multiple fathers, that both were fathers.
Absolutely.
So yeah,
doing very, very well. And I thought that was a great way, and a fantastic film. But, you know, alcoholism, in a way, a one man's alcoholism, especially when he's already leading the Avengers against alien invasions, is just a little too. I could see them playing the Demon in a Bottle storyline out if he found some alien drug. Like maybe the Collector, you know, gets him hooked on something during the Infinity War storyline.
Yeah. But like you're saying it right there, that won't happen. They won't do that because that's too much. That's a spin off of the actual whatever your story is. You're like, cut that out. That's, you know, that's going to derail us.
Right,
so.
Right.
All right, guys. Once again, this is a great episode. I'd like to thank our guests. Robert Meyer Burnett, where
Thank
can
you.
People find you? 49th anniversary of Star Trek. What are you working on, Axanar?
Still working on Star Trek Axanar. You can find it. Our Indiegogo campaign is up at Save the Federation or KlingonVictory.com, SaveTheFederation.com. You can find me on Instagram, RM Burnett, Twitter, Burnett RM, or on Facebook at Robert Meyer Burnett.
Always a pleasure to have you. John Campea, where can people find you?
You can find me Monday through Fridays on Movie Talk, of course, and you can follow me on Facebook and on Twitter at John Campea. And my novel, The Pride, is coming out before the end of the year. My Kickstarter campaign is up right now. We reached, actually, our $12,000 goal in 4 days, so thank you so much for that. Now we're going for our extended goals. You can contribute if you want. Just go to Kickstarter.com and search for The Pride. You'll find the book details there, and keep your eyes open for when the book becomes available.
That's cool, man.
Yeah, definitely go to both of those guys' sites and support them both. It's really important to support independent artists, and I'm 100% for that. Check out my film, The Death of Superman Lives, What Happened, by going to www.tdoslwh.com, where you can get it immediately, a digital download, or you can order a Blu-ray that's chock full of 10 hours of extra features. Robert Meyer Burnett's in the film talking about his time when he was working on Superman Returns. You can find me just at Jon Schnepp or at TDOSLWH online on Instagram and Twitter. And last thing to plug, my film is actually going to be playing here for a limited time in L.A. at the Lamley's Music Hall over on Wilshire Boulevard. You can probably get tickets later this week. It's from September 25th to October 1st. And me and Holly will be at the Long Beach Comic Con this coming weekend, where we'll have a booth selling our movie. We can sign stuff and get all sweaty with you nerds. It'll be fun. Come to Long Beach Comic Con. That's September 12th and 13th. Once again, you've been watching Heroes, episode 24, and I'll see you guys next week.